I think Music for the Masses was a really important record for them because it encapsulated everything about where they were at and the expectation for them at the time.
I thought it was a great record. Music for the Masses was the first Depeche record that I put on and played the whole album.
Music for the Masses for me was one of the most important albums probably from Depeche. It lifted them again.
Their perception, certainly as far as the public went, was of not growing up a bit, but there was a level of depth there.
The band were just becoming more and more of a major force, and they were getting tougher and they were getting darker.
There was a starkness about it, but at the same time it was musically uplifting. So, you know, I just thought the way this band had built to that point in terms of its live following and its fanatical fan base, this was a record that gave that fan everything they ever wanted.
They were unstoppable, really.
Rumors has it, Martin, that you're trying to sneak in guitars in your sound.
We've always used guitars a bit over the years, and with this album we've used them a couple of times as well.
Yeah.
And live, I'll probably be playing guitar on a couple of tracks.
You will. Yeah. Is that a
bought me amp the other day?
Bought an amp and a flying V.
Yeah.
Nice, big spot, gold, glittery.
Yeah.
It's
really smart.
I think heavy metal's in, isn't it?
It's got the sustain.
It's a sustain. They're sort of subtle heavy metal,
yeah.
Slow balance, but they're still heavy.
Yeah, I mean, we're sort of medium weight metal, we like to be called, really.
But you've been into heavy electronic all the time. Is it still possible to work within the electronic frame? Is that still?
Yeah. Electronic metal, yeah, Alan hit it on the head, really. We like electronic metal is where we're at, really.
We used to discuss beforehand how we were going to make each album different from the last. And that became more important to us as time went on, that we weren't just going to repeat a formula.
Because we'd worked on three albums with Daniel and Gareth, and we just felt that we needed some, you know, fresh impetus. I also think that Daniel had had enough of working with us, you know, because, you know, Mute by that time had started to, become quite a big label, you know, on the indie scene, and he had a lot of work to do anyway, so spending months in the studio with us probably wasn't an option for him anyway.
I first got involved because I think Dave Garner heard some stuff I'd been doing with Tears for Fears, and I think the band had decided they wanted to have a bit of a change in the way they made their records, so they got in touch with me.
Dave Bascom, really nice bloke. And done the Tears for Fears, which was great production, and we met him, talked, and he seemed a good man for the job.
Once again, it was just us looking for someone different to work with, and I think we probably sat down and talked to a few people, and Dave just seemed like somebody that we could get on with.
Sometimes you do need some new jokes, someone else to take the piss out of.
Dave was just a fun guy to be around.
When I first met him, as I said, I was expecting these very serious kind of Kraftwerk kind of people. And Fletch, who looks incredibly bookish, you know, his bins and stuff, and he said, yeah, I don't usually go out clubbing much. I used to tend to sit at home and read. And I thought he'd be reading, like, philosophy or something. He was out clubbing every night more than everybody else.
Thank you.
Behind the Wheel's quite an interesting track. It always reminds me, because it has this kind of it's a sequence of four repeating chords, really, that never changes. And it sort of reminds me of one of those optical illusion stairways where you're walking up the stairway and you never get to the top, and once you get round, you're back at the bottom again. And this is kind of how the chord sequence works on there. So you can't stop it, you know, and it has this, and that's the beauty of it, because of the driving analogy of the song. It works really well in that sense, and so we wanted to keep the momentum of that track and build on it.
I remember on the plane, one of the first things Martin was saying was he got the title on the plane over to Paris. He said he got the title first, which is great. I love it when you got that, because it just gives you a whole kind of concept to work towards.
I think it was like a real breath of fresh air for the whole project, you know. And I remember they started the album in Paris, and I remember going down there on the first day, make sure everything was cool and everybody was getting on. I remember leaving the building with like this massive weight off my shoulders.
I mean, being away anywhere, you are this self-contained insular unit, which is, I actually really enjoy. I think it's, you know, you get this kind of team spirit on the go. And so that's the advantage, whereas the stuff we did in London was obviously we were all going home every night and it wasn't quite the same vibe. I wouldn't say there's any particular, apart from the fun of being away, and that there's not any kind of technical advantage to it. I just love going away recording abroad. It's good fun. But I mean, having said that, the studio in Paris was great. It's an old cinema. It was a really good sounding room, lots of interesting spaces. There was like a stairwell we used for a lot of sounds, and also had loads of instruments there, like the big timps and big bass drums. All that stuff was there, so that was really useful, just being able to go and lock up a sound if you wanted it.
Quite a lot of the tracks on there do go in that way, where they just keep going on a theme and build and build and build. Pimp, for example, is very much like that. You end up with a kitchen sink. It starts off with one little riff that just turns around on itself. Again, I think, you know, I've been listening to a lot of Philip Glass at the time and the Minimalists, you know, and so you got this one theme and then we just kept adding and adding and adding to it. But it was very important to have a focus for each track. You know, I think that was more the key, rather than just sort of saying, well, we're going to make this kind of album, because you never really know. What we really needed to do was say, okay, well, each song we're going to say, you know, let's have an idea, a theme of how we're going to try and approach this. I remember Little 15 was quite a difficult track. We left it to the last because we really didn't know how to go about it. You know, we had this song, didn't know what, you know, it was just difficult to know what to do with it. And I can remember I'd just been to see A Zed and Two Noughts by Peter Greenaway. And the sound, all this music to that is Michael Nyman. And so, somewhere amongst our discussions, we said, oh, why don't we try doing it in this sort of Nyman Zed and Two Noughts kind of way. And from there, it was just easy, it just flowed, you know. It just started with a little sort of funny little hypnotic cyclical sequence, and then bang, 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 all the parts came together.
You know, that was Alan's, like, schooling and, you know, his musicianship, and he's a fantastic piano player, Alan. And, and I think we appreciate that at the time.
a lot of the time we were making sounds for the album, and, you know, chucking ashtrays about or something, it just sounded really cool. And we'd kind of think, oh, it'd be great to use that somewhere. So it would end up on something, and then if it didn't fit into an actual song on the album, that little section would have been, oh, let's bung it on the end then. We want to use it somewhere, and if it's got a sort of quite a bit of a dark, mysterious flavour, all the better, you know.
I want you now, tomorrow won't do. There's a yearning inside, and it's showing through.
So it was actually an accordion with just no keys held down. There's there's a button you press on the accordion which just lets the air out, and that's all it was. But it does sound really disgusting. It's great. I want you now. I mean, that song has got some heavy breathing on it anyway, which we sampled from God knows where. I think we sampled it for porn movie, and then we got some girls in to add to it to make it a bit more hi-fi or something.
Never Let Me Down Again was a standout track, and it you know, it was especially effective when we played live.
Well, Never Let Me Down, obviously, was a big song for us, and still is, you know, live.
That was not a big hit. Yeah, it became a real legendary Depeche Mode song. I'm taking a ride with my best friend. I
hope he never lets me down again. Well, Never Let Me Down Again was the one that I really, really was pleased with. I was very involved with the drum sounds on that, and the guitar intro actually was an accident, because it was, again, it's just down to the sequences we were using in those days. We had that guitar was sampled, and it just ran at the wrong. It ran on the counting over the start of the track where it wasn't supposed to be, and we just all went up. That's just great. So that was a happy accident, and it just I always liked the track, and I was really pleased with the way it turned out. It's always very strange, the end of an album for me, because that's when we start getting invaded with everybody else, because obviously they're planning videos, tours, everything, all this, and so there'd be publicity, people coming down and getting in the way. And it's a very close-knit thing you've got going, and suddenly they're off promoting the album and I'm off doing my next thing, so it's always odd getting the end of an album like that, but it's the same with every band.
Music for the Masses was my favourite cover we did for Depeche, and I think it musically inspired me because the songs sounded really big. We were really conscious we had to do something really strong that could carry across on all the merchandising, harking back to the kind of the Eastern European icons and symbols. It always seemed to me like loudspeakers were always like prominent in kind of those countries, and I just had this image of open spaces with loudspeakers, almost like propaganda style loudspeakers, talking to the environment. So, I mean, the idea specifically came from the title, Music for the Masses.
I think we always thought we were pretty comedic with our titles and going against, against the grain.
It was Martin's idea to call the album Music for the Masses, and only really he knows what he was thinking.
I think I was looking through some classical records one day, and I can't remember, it's some, you know, like shop somewhere, and I came across this record called Music for the Millions, and I just thought it was really funny.
Yeah, Music for the Masses, just lots of people took it in a different way, especially after Black Celebration.
We also thought it was ironic because, you know, we didn't really feel that we ever fitted in with the mainstream. So Music for the Masses was, you know, for us, had a tint of irony to it, which was often missed by other people.
I've got to say, it was probably one of the most enjoyable jobs I've ever done, because what we did was we rented a van, We painted the speakers orange, loaded them, bought a scaffold pole and kind of cut it to the right size and mounted them all, and then just fucked off up to the Peak District. You know, I knew kind of wanted to do some stuff up there by Lady Bar Reservoir, and then I wanted to do some of that huge power stage, I think it's Ferry Bridge, off the side of the M1.
It sort of summed up the title, really. You know, it seemed like there was these big speakers there, like, you know, pounding out music to, you know, for the masses. So, you know, and I'd like the symbols that he used from that on the singles.
We did a 12-inch cover where we kind of got a map of Eastern Europe and scrunched it up, and then we kind of put Polaroids on the map and shot it again to make people think that these locations were all over Europe. You know, it was exact opposite of the whole idea of four lads from Basildon, you know, which was not very exotic or bleak or dark, you know.
I think it may have been Dave's idea to bring Anton on board.
I feel really comfortable with Anton, and he kind of understands, you know, the music, and he's very sympathetic to what we're trying to do.
There was more of a focus on us as individuals, and also because the songs were so much about human relationships, you know, there never seemed to be any women involved in any of the work we were doing, so he introduced women into the videos.
Well, you know, I was like into Echo and the Burning Man and sort of rock bands, and Depeche struck me at the time as a sort of teeny bop kind of band, you know, that I didn't mind shooting for the enemy because it's for, you come from a different angle, but to work for them didn't really you know, enter into my train of thoughts.
Anton's attitude of they're just a pop band was the attitude that we were all suffering. And when Anton made the move and wanted to get involved with Depeche Mode, I think that was the point where everything started to become different, because it lent the band that kind of kudos.
And that was my problem, I think, with Depeche Mode. They were seen as this electronic band, and there was no emotion involved in anything that you saw of them. And that I definitely brought in.
Every video that we've ever done with Anton has been fun. Every photo session that we've ever done with Anton is fun. Take Anton out of the equation, it's a nightmare.
But I think he visually saved us, you know.
From my own personal point of view, I thought it was a great album and a great Depeche Mode album because of the look and feel of it, all those sort of the Anton videos, and it really encapsulated what the band was about. So the question was to, you know, was this an album that would move them along in terms of, you know, breaking them to a wider audience?
Because Black Celebration had kind of consolidated the band's position. When they come back with Music for the Masses, Strangelove was a really successful single, really good as an Anton video, wasn't it? With scantily clad females.
Strangelove, to me, is probably the most significant track that this band has had in terms of breaking in America.
It was kind of when it really started to happen. I remember we were on tour in America and the album debuted top 40, And we never really used to concentrate too much on chart positions because, as Andy said, the band could play, sell out 15,000 tickets without even the promoter or some of the promoter's staff not necessarily knowing them. They weren't mainstream.
We created a following long before we were selling records. In much the way bands like the Grateful Dead, or it was like a legion of fans that would come to our gigs, and you know, we could play to 5,000-10,000 people a night, but we were still selling 150,000 albums at the end of a, you know, 30-day tour, which didn't add up.
And that's when it finally crossed over that bang on the Billboard chart. It debuted, or it certainly got into the top 40 that week when we were there. So it was a really important sort of stepping stone then.
It was like America was suddenly really waking up to it, wasn't it? The whole country was...
It was like, hello.
It did suddenly go pop. I mean, they had done all the right things.
Southern California, again, at that time, was different from the rest of the states. Yeah. They'd been champion Depeche for a long time. The radio station there, K-Rock, had been a big supporter of them. And it's almost like its own country, you know.
In a sense, they weren't playing music for the masses. They were playing it for quite an extreme but very advanced niche audience.
You just realized how important this band was to, you know, to those kids. You know, we're talking 16, 17-year-old, Orange County, alienated youth type of thing, whose Depeche Mode's lyrics and music just completely overwhelmed them. So to that extent, that's the, you know, that was the spawning for the movie when we made 101. That was the concept. We just thought, ooh, wouldn't it be good to sort of, you know, bring the fans into the equation. That's why we put a bunch of kids on a bus and sent them across country, because it was really as much about the fans as it was about the band.
92.7 WDRE, New York's new music. Good evening, I'm Malibu Sue, and Depeche Mode are making a movie, and they'd like some of their fans to appear with them. You must be 18 or older and be available to be on location June 10th to the 18th, and just appear at Malibu in Lido Beach this Sunday at 7 p.m. and dress for the movies. Good luck.
I think that was one of the endearing aspects of the movie, because you know, have a band that can hold up that sort of plot line, which really was just, here we are, breaking America. But you know, it was also interesting to view the band through the fans, and it was about the culture, the alternative culture at the time. And there was no one better really to capture than Penny Baker, because that's what he did.
Virgin were doing our distribution, video distribution at that time. There's a guy there called Angus Margerison. And he said, why don't you ask Penny Baker? And I said, Penny Baker, he wouldn't do that. I mean, he's a legend, you know, he's done incredible, you know, some of the most important rock documentaries ever, you know. But we phoned him up and he said, yeah, I'll do it, yeah. We'd done TV shows and bits and pieces, but we'd never done anything like this before. And his whole thing was like, well, you won't notice the cameras, you know, and we're like, well, of course we will. But the whole point of them hanging around us was that
fly on the wall.
That's it.
Penny, you missed it.
I know. Really,
starting the tape.
This is one of the changes.
Oh.
You missed starting the tape.
And we wanted an angle to it. It wasn't, you know, it wasn't some slicked up commercial for the band.
Headlined by Depeche Mode. Right now we have driving into the Rose Bowl in a beautiful convertible classic car. Is that a Cadillac? Just describe that. They are all wearing black leather. They're going to come over to the microphone right now. Depeche Mode! I think Alan has especially prepared a speech for us.
I do, yeah. Good morning. Okay. We want to say a good morning to all our fans listening and watching this morning, and we'd like to announce that as a special final concert to our world tour, on Saturday, June the 18th, we'll be playing a concert for the masses here at the Rose Bowl Pasadena.
Business had gone so well that it was decided to not just to cap off the American tour, but to cap off the whole tour with a special show.
The tour in America had been phenomenal, it had done phenomenal business, and it was a way of making a statement at the end of the tour saying, the band are here.
I think initially we wanted to do like a, you know, an Altamont type, like, you know, free concert for our fans, and that became impossible to put together, probably mainly because promoters didn't want to touch it with a barge pole.
And they decided on a stadium that hadn't been used as a music venue for quite some time, and it's since the 70s, yeah. Was it?
But there was this big thing about whether, you know, whether they would be able to do it. But I think they were obviously nervous that they might be jumping the gun a little bit, because it was a big statement.
It was a very, you know, brave move.
Tell me this, what made you decide to do this? I mean, when I first heard it, I mean, a lot of people, I'm sure, went, God, that is a real risk for this band. Then
we presented the idea to other people, and even people that worked for us at the time, like our agent in the States, Wayne Forte, and other people thought we were kind of mad, including the record company, and that we'd never pull it off.
It was a gamble. There was a small amount of, like, double or quits in it.
When you do a venue indoors, if you don't sell all the tickets, if you only sell half the tickets, you can always put up drapes and stuff like that, so you can kind of block it off and it doesn't look so bad. But when you're outdoors in a place like that, if you don't
exposed.
Sell out, you are.
We were pretty confident that we had the kind of fans that would travel from Texas and New York and all over the place to if we were doing this show.
I was having lunch with someone from BBC Television one day, and he said, "Hey, I'm going to America next week, the film crew, and we're going to be filming the Pet Shop Boys. You know, they're playing the Pasadena Rose Bowl. Do you know, they're headlining 150,000, wherever it was, people, or 100,000 people at the Pasadena Rose Bowl." And I said, "When are you going?" And he gave me the date, and I said, "You know, I don't think the Pet Shop Boys are playing that night. I'm sure it's Depeche Mode." He went, "No, Depeche Mode couldn't play the Pasadena Rose Bowl." And I went outside to use the phone box, and I rang Daniel, and I came back. I was so proud. I sat down and went, "Actually, the Pet Shop Boys are supporting Depeche Mode. Yes!"
There was a lot of pressure on the production people. The show was huge. I remember the riggers looking up in the sky and all the speakers saying, "There's two more than the Grateful Dead up there."
The guy who actually built Woodstock, Chip Monk, his name is. That is his real name. And he had got this idea where you had this stage that was on four pillars and the roof sort of went down to the ground, and then you hung all the lighting and the sound system and stuff like that, and then you just pulled the whole thing up. What, of course, the practicalities of it is when they tried to do it and tried to lift this roof up, it just didn't happen, you know, so then they had to take everything off, and now we were running against time.
After everything else, after, you know, we've had nothing but grief in this whole place with the roof, and everything has been late. Everything that we tried to do has been late. We've had problems with everything. And we've had keyboards blowing up, we've had the lock.
We ended up doing the show, the roof was up, they hung everything from it and got it up into the ceiling, and then they had a crane with a big piece of rope that was actually holding the stage to stop it falling on the crowd.
Yeah. Have you ever tried renting a crane in California on a Friday night?
On a Friday afternoon, it's murder after five. God.
And the weather was miserable. The band did the funniest sound check I've ever seen them do. And Martin was twiddling on a guitar doing something completely offbeat, and there wasn't even a proper sound check. It all felt very disjointed and weird.
And let us play with those two mics.
It was the one show on the tour where we'd had to use a completely different monitoring system and a completely different PA because of the sheer size of the place, and we weren't used to it. So everything went wrong, really. There were lots of things went wrong. I think the keyboards basically worked, but the fold back, couldn't hear ourselves singing. Dave was deafening.
I remember going on stage and I remember losing my voice like I have now, unfortunately, pretty quickly during the show. But somehow managing to pull through. But it was pretty overwhelming.
The movie says it all. Very nervous, you know, the long walk to the stage.
There is nothing like getting 65,000 people in a stadium and hearing that sound. It was a major milestone for the band.
blasphemous rumours, and Dave singing about God having the sixth sense of humour, it absolutely, the heavens opened up. Electrical storm, and then it absolutely poured down. I don't want to start any blasphemous rumours, but I think that God's got a sixth sense of humour.
It was classic. The clouds came over and it suddenly opened up on everybody. It was really wild.
We've always joked about the cloud of doom that seems to follow us around. You know, it doesn't seem to happen so much these days, but there was a time when virtually every night we played anywhere, it rained.
None of the mains electric was covered, and the guys are running around saying, oh, it never, ever rains in California in June. And we were saying, yeah, well, it is now, so can you get the tarpaulin out, please? And it was just, I mean, that's another reason why, you know, radio people and press talked about it, because it actually happened exactly as he was singing that chorus.
It was like that Sympathy for the Devil, Stones trying to sort of play that song. Of course, we lapped that up.
So it was,
it was a big, big event, though, wasn't
yeah,
it? You know,
massive.
I mean, it was a massive gig that they'd sold sort of 70,000 tickets. You know, they were certainly the biggest UK act, if not one of the biggest bands in America at that time.
Dave often says that, you know, he doesn't know how he came up with the idea when we were playing at the Rose Bowl, but he just started like waving his arms in the air, and you know, the whole crowd just in unison started doing it back. Watching that from the stage, yeah, is such a special moment. You can see people, you know, right from the first row right to the very back stand, all doing it in unison. You know, it just looks like a field of wheat or something. You know, it's incredible.
Yeah, I mean, it was pretty amazing. There hasn't really been another concert like it for us. Up until that point, this was our world, you know. And on some levels, that's what's so special about Depeche and everything that's gone on around it, is it was, we created our own sort of utopia and lived in it, you know. And there were, I had a strange feeling at that concert. I remember at the end of it, I really felt like it was all over. There was nowhere to go now with this caravan that we had been dragging around for the last 10 years. And, you know, what are we going to do now? You know, it was almost like we'd reached our destination. It changed. It did change after that. It had to. We had to sort of take it to another level somehow.